That, my friends, is the best song by 1980s wonder group Oingo Boingo. That's really seriously good stuff, I just got to say. And I've been obsessing for just like, I don't know. I've been on a Boingo binge for like just a day. And it's a good binge. I highly recommend it. You didn't like the song? Sorry, man. Yeah, you have to leave. Could you please get out of here? Really. Had enough of your crap. Wait, let me see. I'm trying to learn from presidential role models. I think I'm supposed to tell you to shut up. But I think, to their credit, nobody told anybody else to go F themselves. So there's that. Not as bad as it could have been. My pig meme, my pig wrestling meme, that was prophetic, was it not? Swearing was at a minimum, but it wasn't absent. Yeah. Anyway, yeah, please scream inside your heart. This, to me, it's just the week. The debate pushed me over the edge on this one. Please scream inside your heart, because heaven knows... It was not a debate. It was the one of my sons called it the presidential argument, which it's hard to, you know, it's hard to argue with that. But I like the presidential argument. I think that can work. I called it the presidential crap show. We also called it the peaceful protest, was another thing we called it. I don't know. It was not good reality TV, Devin. There were no chairs thrown. No. I just want to say this. No, I thought that that the mediator, who was it, Chris Wallace? I thought he did great under the circumstances, which is just absurd. Yeah. Anyway, that's all I got for now. Okay, hey, let's get rolling. All right. We all, you know, this is just group therapy at this point, right? We're all kind of like screaming on the inside, I think. Oh man. They did say that on the next debate, they're going to cut the mics, or are considering anyway, cutting the mics in between. When it's not your turn to talk, then you cut the mic. I'm a fan of that. I'm a big, big fan of that. Yeah. Yeah, right, Delia. I mean, yeah, nobody saw that coming, right? Like, no, nobody could have anticipated this outcome. Okay. Let's get on to... Here's the deal. We're going one more day of Cringely. Hey,
quick question.
Yeah.
Or not question.
Who is that, comment. Devin? Sounds like Devin.
Yeah, it's me. I messaged just a tiny bit ago. So the notes are for parts 2 and 3, but I only have part 1.
No, I messaged you on, I sent it to you on Discord.
The video?
No, you have all the videos, don't you?
No, that's what I mean. I only have part, so Nerds 1, parts 1 through 8, but not like the separate 2, 3 videos. Mm. Like, it's just the first part split up into 8.
Okay, you didn't have 2 and 3. Okay, oh man, okay, yeah, well, let's get that fixed real quick. You got the notes, though, that I sent you, right, Devin?
Yeah, I have those pulled up right now.
Okay.
But, yeah, I'm sure that they're already online. I just need, they're not shared with me.
Yeah, crapsky. Yeah, I wish we'd have taken care of that earlier. Okay, hang on a second. Sorry for the delay, friends. We just had a shared drive, didn't we, Devin?
It was just, I had an email sent to me with the files.
It had to be because it's big. It wasn't in an email, I don't think.
Yeah, no, it's a shared drive, but in the file that's shared with me, it's just part one.
Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out, this is a Google Drive though, right?
Oh yeah, it's folder. Just a Google Drive. So if I just have the link or whatever, or have it shared, I'll be able to see it. I'm already in the drive right now.
Okay, yeah, I'm just trying to find the dumb drive myself now, in my stuff. Oh, there we go. Okay.
I joined and you immediately say, there we go. So I'm like, oh, you guys are waiting for me. Thank you.
No, okay. So Devin, they're there. Those other folder, those other files are in there.
They're in the same file?
No. If you're at, the shared drive is called Cringely Triumph for the Nerds. And there's volume one, Impressing Their Friends. Volume 2, Riding the Bear. Volume 3, Great Artists Steal.
So, here, let me... It looks like only Volume 1 is shared with me.
Oh, it's the share factor. Okay, da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da. Dumb. Okay, hold tight. We're like seconds away from success here.
Yeah.
No, I see it.
It's already there.
Yeah, they're there in the folder. Yeah. No, that's totally... Yeah, okay. My bad.
I see volume 3 now.
Yeah, you're going to see the other one now just real quick. Boom.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I've got it right.
All right. Okay, sweet. Thank you. Okay. All right. Let's rock and roll. What do we got? Okay, let me jump back over on the chat. Okay, let me see. Your debate memes are just incredible. Just got to say that. Yeah, group therapy. Anyway, what else we got? Okay, so Eric asked, what are we going to hit after History of Computing? Let me tell you about that real quick. Because, as you know, we're kind of fake it till we make it. And here's where we are right now. And let me blow that up so we can kind of just see... But this is our last, I'm going to just wrap up today. We're wrapping up Cringely one way or the other. I want to talk about Cringely for a second, but then when we're done with Cringely on Tuesday, we're going to talk about social media, which has been, it's been unspeakably transformative. Social media has been unprecedentedly transformative. I don't know if that's a word, but if not, I just made it up. What social media has done is just absolutely freaking remarkable. I don't have any readings yet. Again, we're fake it till we make it. And there's none out here either. You see where we're at? Oh, I appreciate your patience and your forgiveness. But that's where we're going next. And then on Thursday, we're going to talk about cybersecurity, espionage, and specifically about the cuckoo's egg. So you need to have the cuckoo's egg. You need to have the cuckoo's egg cooked by next Thursday, okay? I want to break it down, talk about it, and then we'll spend 2 days on kind of security and espionage kinds of stuff. Literally the biggest challenge that I'm having with all of this is just that there is so freaking much, all these topics are so rich that distilling it is honestly my biggest problem. And then it just takes time. You know what I mean? And then it all is so massive, and then condensing it down to say, what do we talk about if we have an hour? Does that work, Eric? Does that kind of make sense where we're going? It's a great question. I'm glad you asked it. And oh my crap. The memes are going fast and furious here, and I can't even track them. I got to go back when I'm done, and because they're just incredible. Let me see. Does that show up over there? That is my favorite. I just want to say. Oh, yeah, it was a dumpster fire. Okay, let's just say it. Okay. That's it. Okay, let's go. What are we doing? I want to talk some Cringely. But here's what I want to say about Cringely that I think is, there were a couple comments that I saw about, I'm curious about kind of how you're feeling about Cringely, first of all. It is a little cutesy. Here's the thing about Cringely. What happens is that he lays into, there is, you know, I lived through all of this, and in all of these things, you can talk about, pick anything, Google as a company, right? Facebook as a company. These are all really transformative things. Amazon as a company, Facebook as a company. There's just some crazy, crazy transformative technologies and companies and products. But the core revolution, and this might be just a function of my own age, but if there's no Steve Jobs and if there's no Bill Gates, and if there was no, if there was no von Neumann, if there was no Turing, if there was no, this whole thing, there's no anything that we're doing right now. I mean, it's just, that to me is like so pivotal that, before there was Facebook, there was MySpace, right? The whatever it is, kind of the trashy trailer park of the internet back in its day. I don't know, might still be, for all I know. But I'm just saying, sorry, the memes are still just going crazy. And before that, it was AOL. Thank you, Franklin. There's so many things, but the PC revolution, the dawn of the PC revolution, the things that happened at Xerox PARC where they invented the personal computer, basically invented Ethernet. All these legendary people were all like there at Xerox PARC. Bob Metcalf inventing, Ethernet, and Alan Kay doing smart talk, object-oriented programming and stuff. It's remarkable, again, that convergence, the Homebrew Computer Club and all that, That to me is actually sort of like the Big Bang. And then there's all these amazing little additional ripples. Especially when you get to things like the web, which I would kind of sometimes refer to as the internet as we know it, kind of shows up in the mid-90s, and I'm in grad school when that happens, but anyway, and I want to talk for a second. If you have, okay, for those that are either not posting political memes or just watching political memes go by, like I know I am, I just want to get your sense to this point, and I've got my notes on the rest of Cringely, and I'm probably just going to bop around to what I think are the big highlights. You should have all seen it by now. But what is your sense right now? And I'm less interested in a critique of the crappy television production quality of the mid-90s than I am about what it's doing historically. You know what I mean? What it means historically. What are your thoughts, feelings about that? What do you got? I'm waiting. Can you hear me? Are you talking and I can't hear you? Or are we okay on volume?
Nobody has actually said anything in...
All right. Okay. So it's not... So, no. Okay. Yeah. So talk... What are you saying, Denver? The overly flattering of the subjects. Yeah. Okay. So, Frank, so let's pause the feed for a second. Let's pause the memes, if we may. Okay. But, no, the question is... Cringely, you know, the history, the not a critique of Cringely as you know, as a, you know, show host, but rather the history itself, what you're seeing in those things, you know, in those three episodes. Okay, I just gave my own contribution. Okay, so now I hope we can move on. Let's pause. Now that I got my digs in, let's pause on the presidential memes. Yeah. So tell me about J-Dog. Yeah. So what is Great Man Theory, and what is it, and why is it disappointing? You know, I just, and if you can jump on the audio, again, just understand your audio, go to YouTube, but if, you know, for a little more interactivity.
Sure, I can jump on audio.
Yeah.
Basically, Great Man Theory is the relatively modernist theory started by Thomas Carlyle, which is that theory is almost exclusively pushed forward by great men and nothing else. And it has two basic assumptions, which is every great leader is born already, possesses certain traits, and the need for them has to be great for these traits to arise, allowing them to lead. And it just feels like he focuses far too much on just individual people rather than the global climate at the time and other lenses that could possibly contribute to the advancing of computer history.
Okay, no, that makes total sense. Now, by the way, and when you talk about the great man theory, you're not speaking of that, I presume... That's not being addressed like in a gender specific way, man is a sort of a universal for humanity, or is it literally like men versus women?
No, but it's just like a general, it's like pushed the great people.
Okay, the great person. Okay, I just wanted to clarify what the intent of that, you know what I mean, of that idea was. But I mean, this is an interesting question though, right? And I'm not familiar with it under that name. You know what I mean? I'm not familiar with the theory by that name, although I'm now I have to go do some research and some homework. But the notion of, so you said, I mean, you said one thing, which was, other lenses through which you could view it. And I think there's no question about that. But one of the lenses through which you can view it is if you take Bill Gates out, there is no Microsoft, and there maybe is a PC revolution, but maybe it's 20 years later. You know what I mean? You take Steve Jobs out, and you know, there are in fact key people that if they don't do the thing they did when they did it, you take Alan Turing out, you take von Neumann out, you know what I mean? It's not like the residents of New Jersey created Unix, you know, Brian Kernahan and Ken Thompson you know what I mean, created Unix. New Jersey didn't create Unix. You know what I mean? Bell Labs didn't even create Unix, but there's a climate. So I don't, you know what I mean? I'm not even like disagreeing with the idea that there are lenses through which we can see those things. But you'd still have to say, you know, so like, I mean, like, the, okay, hitting a couple of these comments, and then if you want to jump in again, as Erica said, I think things would still happen even without Jobs and Gates. Absolutely. But they wouldn't be the same things. Maybe that's good, maybe that's bad. You know what I mean? You know, I don't know.
Can I hop in real quick?
Yeah, please, Erica.
So there's a mathematical proof came out recently about time travel that basically said that if you remove the players, you don't remove the history. So, like, if you got rid of person zero or patient zero of COVID, COVID would still happen. It would just happen in a different way. And so that's why I'm like, I think if you get rid of Gates and Jobs, things would still more or less happen similarly.
Yeah. Well, let me throw another one. So Franklin, thanks for posting that about great man theory with a picture of Napoleon. Let me take it to kind of the extreme, take the limit of the function, right? I also want to win Godwin's law on this post, on this exchange, by being the first one to bring up Hitler. But I believe if you take Hitler out of the equation, there might still be World War II. I don't know that there's a Holocaust without Hitler. You know what I mean? There would still be things, but would there have been that thing? You know what I mean? That's the burning question to me. Because when you see, you know, pure genius, right? You take Isaac Newton out, what happens? You take Einstein out, what happens? I don't think there was just another bunch of, you know, I mean, on the other hand, sure, there were, in fact, other physicists doing related things, you know? I don't know. These are great questions. Because what I'm trying to get you to do with Cringely is look back, as painful as the old video might be, to look back at the history and the dawn and to see the very tiny, you know, the very, like we talked about last time, the very thin threads, you know, the small hinges on which these doors of history, you know, kind of pivot, you know, because I think they really do, which maybe means, it might just mean that I am in fact a proponent of great man theory without having actually been directly exposed to it. Therefore, I'm not subscribing to everything in there because I don't know what's in there. You know what I mean? I'm not saying I'm the big advocate of that theory because I don't know all of the implications. But I do think that there are key people show up. Yeah, yeah, please.
Can I bounce in a couple ideas off
you?
Yeah,
Denver, man, go.
So I had a couple thoughts because it makes me think of, we think Darwin's pretty great. I mean, he changed the world with his theories on evolution, for example. But maybe even his discovery, I think, was inevitable because someone else discovered it independently and at about the same time as him. We only recognize Darwin, but the only reason he published when he did was to beat someone else to the intellectual rights.
Right, right. I think that's quite reasonable. And also, when you look at, again, you look at history, and there were people doing what Newton was doing at the time Newton was doing it, right? Relative to calculus.
Perfect.
You know, what
perfect,
right?
Yeah.
You know. The interesting question, though, I think we could say this as kind of a truism, that it wouldn't have happened in that way. I think we can all agree that, you know what I mean, that wouldn't be exactly the same. And that's kind of like,
I mean, that's tautological.
That's tautological, right, exactly. That doesn't take a lot of courage, not a lot of intellectual courage to make that statement. The question is, I think, really one of degree, right? You know, if you take those players out, you know, I mean, if you take Turing out, there was that whole group, right, that was working on cracking Enigma. It wasn't just Alan Turing, and there's some inaccuracies in the movie, right? The Imitation Game. Because there was that entire group. But would the group, you know what I mean? If you take Turing out, do they crack that? And then if they crack that, does the war end the same way? You know, cue the credits for The Man in the High Castle, I guess. But You know what I mean? I mean, are there in fact situations where, you know, there really is a pivot? And again, would something have happened? You know what I mean? If there hadn't been a Hitler, would somebody have come along somewhere along the line and found an excuse to kill 6 million Jews? Possible. Could have been one of the guys, you know, that opportunistically glommed onto him. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I'm following along.
Yeah,
it's interesting.
And I don't know, right? I really don't know the answer. And so I'm really digging the exploration, you know?
I love it. I think that I sit a little bit to the side of, I'm probably opposite you, just my preconception, right?
Yeah, yeah.
But, I kind of tend to think of it like the lottery, for example. Like, oh, if one person didn't win, probably someone else would have won. A lot of people are vying for that, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know what's interesting, Denver? I was once at some, I don't know, family gathering or something where I got into trouble because I said that I thought, relative to Steve Jobs, right? In my mind, there's no question that he was packing a certain kind of genius. But I said that I thought that there were at that time, and this was kind of in a Jobsian heyday, whenever that was. It was probably on the return of Jobs, because Cringely ends with Jobs out and Apple fading. Jobs comes back, which is another interesting story. He comes back, Jobs 2.0, kinder, gentler Jobs, you know, and still does,
right,
you know,
right,
some amazing things. I said that I felt like there were probably 10,000 people on the planet that were as smart as Jobs about the things that Jobs was smart about. And I caught some crazy crap at dinner for that one. You know what I mean? But that's actually really more toward your, that was me being more on your
celebrity
side.
You know, he's still quite an influence. He's kind of inspirational, right?
Yeah, no, that's right. And so Mason said, right?
A lot of people have a very strong regard for him, regardless of whether you're right. I think it's a hard opinion to state.
Yeah, no, that's right. And I was kind of trying to say, I don't know what I was trying to say. And as always, I don't even know that I agree with things I said 6 months ago, because we're always, you know what I mean? You ought to be constantly ingesting new information, perspectives, ideas, and your own thinking ought to be changing. You know what I mean? But so Mason just posted, you know, that if it wasn't agreeing with Dahlia, that if it wasn't them, we'd be talking about, you know, some other group of people, right? Some collection of individuals and what made them special. And, you know, and that's like I talked about a couple class periods ago, that, you know, the victors write the history books. That's an old adage, right? That the victors write the histories. So of course you know about Zuckerberg, but you don't know about who it would have been if there hadn't been a Zuckerberg, or if the serendipity hadn't just aligned around him that caused him to become that, right? You know, or the Jeff Bezos, right? Would somebody have done those same things if it hadn't been for him? You know, and I kind of have to feel like yes, and then we'd be talking about that person and reading their biography, you know? Because there is, but the interesting thing, I do think that there are threads where history really does sort of diverge and dramatically on the hinge of small actions by specific people. So I don't know if that, again, I don't know if that aligns me with great man theory or not. Because again, I don't know the theory by the name, and I'm now super interested in what that means. And of course we're just discussing, and unlike those folks, we're not at one in particular, we're not like talking all over each other and screaming shut up and things. So we're far more dignified in this exchange, but I'm really, really loving it.
Can I hear your thoughts on one more idea?
Yeah, Denver, yeah.
It's that, you know, in response to your analogy of Hitler, right? Like, yeah, maybe he's uniquely awful, right?
Yeah.
It's close to the issue of the Nuremberg trials, because a similar sentiment was, oh, Nazis are uniquely violent and horrible or something, right?
Yeah.
But
yeah,
we
yeah.
have your thoughts on the Milgram experiment then, right? Because that would say, that would debunk that.
I don't know the Milgram experiment.
Oh, you'll love it.
Will you drop a link for so we can?
Yes, I will.
Yeah, because we've had other chats, and I think you know I'll love it. And that's not the same as the Stanford Prison Experiment, is it? That Tyler just dropped.
Oh, you're in the ballpark. It is the same idea.
Okay, I mean I'm familiar with the Stanford Prison Experiment, but not Milgram Experiment, or at least not by that name.
Well, the prison experiment will suffice just
is
fine.
This, is your this the one?
On that?
Oh, Milgram, I do know that one. Yeah, I didn't know it by that name. Yeah, I know a lot about that one. Yeah, no, okay. Understand too that my thoughts are only as good as any of yours. You know what I mean? I'm older.
Oh, I love it. Yeah.
But you know just what I mean? I'm not trying to say, okay, everybody, please get ready because I'm going to give you the definitive answer that it's all going to be on the test. You know, I don't roll. I think you all know I don't roll that way. No, it is my opinion that the rank and file. This is the part where I can now. I'll never be able to run for president after what I'm about to say. I think that the rank and file German citizen, non-Jewish German citizen, and the rank and or the rank and file Nazi and or the rank and file Italian fascist. And or the rank and file Japanese soldier slash kamikaze pilot, whatever, right? World War II, the bad actors in World War II are not so different from the general mass of humanity in any given generation. That's my bold ass statement that will mean I can never run for president. I don't even know exactly why it disqualifies me. I only feel that it does somehow. You know what I mean? I don't know. What do you think of that? Are you buying? I don't even know if I'm buying. That's just my cut sitting here right now.
Sorry,
that's
reconcile
an important
it with
thing
your...
to observe because it means that any of us are just a couple moral decisions away from doing something heinous potentially. I think that's a good thing to be
right?
wary of.
But I think that's what Milgram kind of was about, right? That same idea that there are just people that, you know, you think you wouldn't. And I think that the people who are like, well, if I had been alive, blah, blah, fill in the dot. You know what I mean? Fill in the blanks, right? If I had been whatever, you put yourself, you teleport yourself back. I mean, let's go for something again that'll disqualify me for every public office. The people who are willing to say, and by the way, maybe this is true or maybe it's not, who are willing to say, well, if I had been alive, you know, say in 1700, I would have been an abolitionist, right? I'd sure as hell like to think I would have been. You know what I mean? I know how I feel now, but I'm operating with sort of modern sensitivities, and I have no idea what I would have felt in that environment. I just think we're all cocky and arrogant when we look backwards and say, those people were a certain brand of barbarism and we're somehow, you know, uniquely better, evolved, progressed, you know what I mean? Because, and here's why, at the end of the day, it comes down to humanity. In my view, it comes down to, there is an element of humanity and that humanity is a human, humanity's humanity. Good and evil coexist. And as you said, I can't remember what your name is because it doesn't pivot on the handle, but Captain. That we're all thank you, Kathleen. That we're all a couple moral decisions away from certain things, and I'm extremely concerned whenever mob dynamics get involved. I do mean mob, and I'm choosing that word specifically and deliberately. You know what I mean? I'm not talking about majority rule or democracy. I'm talking about mob ethics. When mob ethics come into play, everybody loses their ever-loving effing mind. That is my campaign slogan. When I run in 2024, when mob dynamics come into play, everybody loses their effing mind. But there's a lot of that. You do things in that moment, and there's some other dynamics. And, you know, we're out of my pay grade for sure, you know. Not out of my interest range, you know. But as always, Denver, great questions. Great, great, great thought-provoking questions. You want to write me in? Should we write me in? I'm trying to figure out who to vote, who to write in on this upcoming election.
I think if we got all 60 of us, we have a chance.
Anyway. I don't know.
Better than Kanye.
Yeah, no, I think, yeah. I don't have his money, though. I do not have that guy's money, that's for sure. Or musical talent. So, anyway. Yeah, so right, as Michael said, I don't think we have any idea what we would have actually been. I think it's convenient to say, had I been alive, that wouldn't have been me. But, you know what I mean? And I look at it this way, and it relates to the debate, and it relates to things I've seen in videos this year during a lot of the dynamics, you know, the political and social dynamics. You show me somebody who is willing to scream, this is generic again, but you show me anybody in any generation who's willing to scream in the face of another human, and I will show you somebody capable of very, very dark actions. And they would have been capable of those dark actions in every generation, and the manifestation simply would have been different. But I don't trust the people willing to scream at me and yell at me, you know what I mean, and hurl profanity at me as being any kind of voice of reason about anything. And I don't even care what the cause is. I don't even care if I agree with the cause. That behavior dehumanizes. And any behavior that dehumanizes, I think, is bad play. So, Franklin, you're going to have to drop some actual campaign literature about your two candidates. We're happy to see that. Anyway, but let's pivot it back to technology. And these are great. These are great questions and thoughts, right? Because one of the things that happens right now, think about this, because we're going to talk about social media coming up. You realize how many of these dynamics just could not have happened without Twitter, you know, for better or worse. Couldn't happen without Facebook, probably. Couldn't happen. Because one of the things that happens, which we'll talk about, one of the things that happens is when I was a kid, can I do the old when I was a little kid thing? When I was a little, back in my day, we had the three channels, right? ABC, CBS, NBC. And it was black and white when I was a kid. Everything was, the actual world was black and white. There was no colorization of the world. It was literally black and white. that's why Rembrandt, another of the famous painters, was so amazing, because when they painted, it was actually color, even though they themselves were actually black and white. And everybody shared a certain kind of cultural literacy. You know what I mean? We'd get to school in the morning and we'd all be talking about Johnny Carson's monologue to start off the Tonight Show, because everybody watched the same monologue. I don't even know it was on the other channels at that point. You know what I'm saying? There was like a shared, everybody watched either Walter Cronkite or Tom Brokaw, you know, or one of these people. There was a set of people you could see reading you the news, and that's where you got your news, and that was it. Everybody shared that sort of cultural literacy. Today, you roll your own. You build your own echo chamber. You know? Think about that, right? I can go to Twitter. I follow whoever I want to follow. I block whoever I don't want to be heard, you know, hear from. Somebody starts to really piss me off, I block them or I just unfollow them. Right? So Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, whatever, you create your own, you know, your news feeds. You create your own news feeds. The podcasts you listen to, you create your own feed. There's never been a generation in the history of humanity that could create their own world of their, you know, a world of their own creation, to hear only what they wanted to hear that made them feel validated, you know, or intelligent or smart or morally superior or whatever. And by the way, this is absolutely across the political spectrum. This is not, if you're sitting there going, yeah, damn Democrats, you know, or if you're like, you know what I mean? Yeah, damn Repugs, you know, if you're doing that, you're part of the problem. Okay. This is everybody, is dealing with that same thing. Everybody gets to make their own echo chamber. So the courageous thing in my view is to, if you're going to have that, to actually continue to read and hear and listen to people you just flat out disagree with, just to percolate and not just drop into the echo chamber where you just get nothing but validation. That's when people get crazy, and that's when they lose their minds. And everybody else looks like Satan at that point.
There's no shame anymore. You can just go curate your list of friends and have whatever dumb idea you want, and your curated group is not going to tell you how you have a stupid idea.
No, that's right. That's right. Until the stakes get much, much, much bigger when you finally find out, right? It's a little of that. But it's aided and but you understand it's aided and abetted by computer science. That's the crazy part.
Are we the baddies?
We're the baddies. I don't know. I don't think so, right? I mean, technology is what it is, right? I mean, you know, you can, you know what I'm saying? Technology is always a tool. You know, in a sense, you could say that all technology really does is like accelerate, you know, the whole thing. You know, I don't know. Denver, I do think that villainizing those who villainize is in fact a little bit hypocritical, and that there is a position to take above that. I think that actually exists. Anyway. Yeah, Kathleen, the discourse, the exhaustion, right? You have the famous meme, if somebody wants to find it and drop it, which is, you know, what is it? Honey, come to bed. And he goes, I can't, somebody is wrong on the internet. Did somebody find that one? You know the one, right? I'm pretty sure you've seen it. James, IBM and the Holocaust? No, I don't know this book. Okay, wow, okay, fascinating. Anyway, but yeah, it's really remarkable. The Arab Spring is another example, which we'll talk about relative to social media. We talked a little bit about this. Thank you. Yeah, it's an XKCD. You know, that when Boris Yeltsin came to power, you know, after the fall of the Berlin Wall and the fall of the Soviet Union, they had to have technology to communicate, because what you try to do in order to control in a totalitarian government, read Machiavelli. Here's another one that'll get me, you know, forever unemployed from public office, but I think Machiavelli got a bad rap. He did not advocate the most evil things he explained, but he did say, if this is how you want to do it, this is how you do it. He did say, there are better ways of doing this, and here's what I recommend. So he wasn't, you know, we kind of go Machiavellian as being sort of evil and, you know what I mean, purely, you know, purely utilitarian and non-moral, etc. So, but he wasn't an enabler. Yes, Denver. Denver, I love your comments. Yes, Machiavelli was. And he was also a political aspirer, right? The book that you read when you read Machiavelli is called The Prince, right? Because he was trying to... He was a suck-up. Absolutely was a suck-up. And also just sort of like strategically brilliant. But if you're going to do the exposition about the topic, that's what it looks like. So anyway, I've read a lot of Machiavelli. Try not, you know what I mean? That's why I've succeeded as well as I have in my life and in business. Anyway... Technology. You have to have technology for the interconnect. You know, for the interconnectedness. Ever since, you know, we left sort of small feudal society and things like that, it's really remarkable. But but the Arab Spring again, you know, heavily driven and facilitated by social media, like Twitter, like Facebook, right? The ability to like generate a flash mob. Everybody shows up. You know, does the thing, and then so let me ask you this question and get like verbal answers. This happened in you know, during the Arab Spring in these Arab dictatorships, where there was like one after another was like falling and becoming democratic, right? Okay, and independent of that setting, there, when, if you're part of a majority, let's just say whatever, I mean, think about it. If you're an average Italian, you're not in World War II, you're not actually happy about what's going on. If you're an average German, you're not actually happy about what's going on during World War II. But you have a reign of terror, and the reign of terror in large measure includes information control, right? And information control and a narking on your neighbor, right? With high public shaming and frankly, cancel culture, okay? We can get into that, but I think frankly, 2020 modern technologically driven cancel culture is not unlike cancel culture, where it's not just, oh, whatever, you know what I mean? We'll get into that later. But what I'm trying to say is that you have to fear, you have to live in fear that you don't know which of the neighbors on your block is the informer. And as soon as you speak out of line, it's thought control. It's thought control. You're not free to just say, I kind of disagree. Why don't you persuade me? Disagree? How can you disagree? What are you? Some kind of fill in the blank with some extremist, you know what I mean? Extremist paint. Okay, so here's my question. So you have to have kind of a thought control, and you have to have the fear that anybody could possibly be snitching on you, family member, neighbor, whatever, if they found out that you simply thought a certain way, right, which is really what 1984 as a novel, you know, really, really drives home. And it was the culture in the Soviet Union. It was the culture, you know, in every dictatorship, basically. You have to control thought, and then you have to control information flow. But now imagine that on a given day, you're in that climate in a dictatorship. Because, right? Because if everybody, if you just knew that 90% of everybody around you agreed with you, what stops you from just going over there and taking them out of power? What stops you? Okay. If you could suddenly just, everybody just mass in the streets, and a million people gather in like 5 minutes, and everybody just goes chant, 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 chant for like 10 minutes. And before the tanks can roll in, right, you then just disperse. Okay. And you're one of those people. What did that just do to you? And by the way, you can't do that without social media. What does that do to you as a participant in that environment? What do you think? I'm going to pause for a second on that one. I really want to know what you think about that one. Right. Tyler says power to the masses, but power in what form? Power. I mean, you came together for 10 minutes and you dispersed, Tyler. You didn't like, you know, march on City Hall and, you know, kill the mayor or whatever. You just gathered.
If you can do that once successfully, then you can do that again and maybe next time enact more change.
Right, right. So, yeah, Mason, the question is, everybody gathers in a flash mob and then disperses. You're in a city, let's say you're in a city of 2 million people, and 500,000 people gather all of a sudden in the town square, chant, 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 disperse. What did you get out of that? Like right now, in that moment, what did you get out of it? Nothing changed at this point. What'd you get?
You also know that you're not in the minority.
You're not alone. Exactly. You know, it is cathartic, but not only, I don't think. You know you're not alone. You recognize the power in that, right? Because it's that separation and that I can't talk to anybody about what I'm thinking because I could just get killed. And in those dictatorships, literally, it's like, yeah, I think the supreme dictator, El Duce, you know, I think El Duce is a really bad guy and I think he's scum, you know. Well, you might just die the next week. In that environment, you don't say, I think El Duce, that was the nickname of Mussolini, right? And this is also part of why, can I just say this? This is also part of why it really makes my butt tired when people hurl the Nazi thing or talk about fascism or dictatorship because, you know, somebody is like the biggest a-hole ever to occupy the Oval Office. That's not fascism. Fascism is you tweet that and you're dead the next week, in my opinion. You know what I mean? We got to be careful about if you take the limit of the function and everything is Hitler before you even start, where do you go after that? Where's your room to work after that? You know what I mean? And if you actually read what happens, there was a day in the early, I recommend The Rise and Fall of the Third Reich, which I'm actually about halfway through right now. Anyway, there was a day early in the reign and the rule, whatever, of Hitler, where all of the political enemies, literally on a given day throughout Germany, hundreds of his people, just like on the very same day, show up on doorsteps, you know, Herr so-and-so, boom, shoot you right on your doorstep. And there were like several hundred people that were key dissidents, opponents, political opponents, whatever, on the very same day that were all basically just assassinated, you know, on the doorstep. That's the reign of terror. And then when that happens, man, nobody dares say anything. You know, that's the reign of terror. And this is why I'm so passionately pro-free speech, even when what you have to say offends me, right? The freedom to be offended. I know we're pivoting into these other topics, but it's because so long as I can say it and we can disagree and then have a discussion about it, we're not in a reign of terror. As soon as I don't have the freedom to say whatever the thing is, then you're setting up an environment in which a reign of terror can be actually successfully implemented. My opinion, and I could be wrong. Obviously, I could be wrong. We had this conversation already, right? In fact, I'm confident that at least one thing I've said since we started was wrong. I just don't know which one at this point. Hopefully, you'll help me with that. Anyway, does that kind of make sense? But this is also where again, social media, the speed of communication facilitated by personal computers, then they get smaller, then they get the smartphone. You know what I mean? Then we get into this world in which that information is constantly with us. Anyway, but I don't know that there's another major, college major, you know, university major, that lives in this same kind of world, you know, that we live in computer science, that you think about, you know what I mean? You think about the pioneers of our field, at every generation, and just recognize how dramatically the world has changed. You know, think about, it's the mid-90s, 25 years ago, and the web shows up. The web is a product, not as a spec. You know what I mean? The World Wide Web as a spec with Tim Berners-Lee, you know what I mean? Vint Cerfin. The internet existed before the web, right? But when the web kind of showed up in the mid-90s, and then you fast forward 25 years, you know, and you take the web away and then maybe people die? It's crazy. It's really, really insane. What major, what field of study? I mean, maybe virology, certain fields of medicine. I mean, there's some things that have been, you know what I mean, revolutionary in their place. But in terms of absolute pervasiveness, I don't think there's anything quite like this major that we're in, computer science. I don't know, thoughts on that? And I know a bunch of you are now going ham on, you know, whether Trump's a fascist and stuff like that, you know. And by the way, everything at the end of the day has to come down to definitions. You know that, right? We do a lot of talking past each other, you know what I mean, about what we mean when we say what. And I think it's really critical. I've had some conversations with some of you. It's really critical to take the time to drill down. So at least I know, okay, I now know what you mean when you say this. And here's what here's the term I use for that same idea. So at least you're talking in order to understand and not just spouting to be understood. You know, one of Covey's seven principles was seek first to understand and then to be understood. I think there's deep truism to that expression, you know, of seeking. I think it's a It's not just incredible in personal relationships, right? Everybody wants to feel heard and understood. But again, back to the yelling, back to the debate, right? And let's be fair. I mean, the interrupting and the yelling was, in my view, clearly one-sided. Both participated, but, you know, I mean, to Biden's credit, he didn't just say, oh, yeah, go F yourself, which maybe many of us might have done in the same circumstances. Do you know what I'm saying? If you did the statistical analysis, Trump interrupted more and was far more, you know, in terms of tone. No shock. Nobody saw that coming. But I am trying to say that even the political system and the debate system sets up that you have to make your statement. You know what I mean? You can't just be like, I don't know. What do you mean by that? I don't know. Wow, that's really interesting. I like what you just said. That changes, you know, me just a little bit. And that aggregates with other things I'm thinking, right? I have that experience every week of my life. I have that experience of talking to somebody and just going, okay, that's a new interesting thing. Now, I may just be getting so old that this goes along with hiding my own Easter eggs, constantly meeting new people. You know what I mean? Constantly finding new things, constantly making new discoveries. No, but you know what I mean? I feel like, I would love to see the kind of a discussion. And there are a handful of people that I saw in, you know, in on both sides, very small handful of people, you know, that I feel like had that ethic. Does that make sense? The ethic. I'm not talking about whether you like their policy. You know what I mean? Or who you would appoint to the Supreme Court versus them. I'm talking about the willingness to field a question and actually answer the question you fielded instead of pivoting to a pre-canned speech. Everything's about statement and confidence and assurity and not about questionness and opening and listening. And I just think that's so screwed up. That's my opinion. And the only opinion on yeah, that. Go ahead. What's that?
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, it's okay. I'm on a roll. Someone has to interrupt me. Go. Yeah, what did you want to say?
I think a lot of it has to do with, I mean, I'm not talking about the debate last night because that was just a train wreck.
Yep.
But if you look at a debate where there's some kind of substantive topic of conversation and it's not just them going at the other candidates' throats, you still don't get a whole lot of, you know, nuance on the issues. You see one candidate as the champion of this issue and this way of looking at it, and then you see the other person as an opponent to that. Whereas they, like socialism bad, socialism good, where it's...
Right.
There's just so much... I feel like the moment that on a debate stage, two people agree, they've already both lost. In terms of how we look at it in America, yeah. Right?
Yeah. But one of my questions, I guess, and I totally agree with you. One of my burning questions is there any opportunity in this electorate of America? We are very deep in group therapy right now, but damn it, I think we need it. At least I do. I don't know, right? And it does relate. And I keep saying technology about every 3 seconds, right? You got to say technology. There's a question that they often ask in debates, which is, what is something, you know, about which you agree with your opponent, right?
Mm-hmm.
I love that question. And I think maybe once or twice, you know, that I've seen that answered honestly. And sometimes it's like, oh, you know, whatever. They get really nervous and, you know. And I love it when they're just like, no, we both agree. I'd love it just one time for someone to say, we both want to solve poverty. We just, you know, have different ideas about how you do that. But, I, you know, the ability to say, I think my opponent, Mr. Scumdog, you know, really cares about issue X. I right?
Yeah, I think that mindset really just drives the polarization of the public, especially in modern politics.
Yeah.
Because you'll get a lot of candidates, especially like your Republican Party versus Democratic Party, where at least as far as lots of economic policies and some social policies and things like that, you have a solid amount of overlap between the party stances on certain things.
Right.
But everybody sees them as, the Republicans are as far right as right can be, and the Democrats as far left as left can be, which is quite honestly not true. Right. And you have a lot of politicians today, at least in my view, that what they'll do is once their opponent, on the debate stage or on the campaign trail or whatever that might be, once their opponent makes some kind of bold statement, they'll immediately counter that without even thinking if they actually agree with that or not.
Yep. Yep.
And I think the positions of our politicians and of our representatives are just getting polarized by the other side because they want to win instead of concede that, oh, hey, actually, I don't know too much about this issue. I think you might be right.
Yeah.
There's no such admission because people don't want to be wrong. They think, right. I've had a consistent record for 45 years. That means I've been right for 45 years. And I don't think those things are both equivalent.
Yeah, no, I absolutely agree with you, Xander. And, and in fact, if you do change, then you open yourself up to being called a flip-flopper, right?
Right.
When the reality is everybody ought to be an evolver. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? Everybody ought to be evolving. But in fact, if you look at political spectrum, things have actually been polarizing for the last, 20, 30, 40 years. More and more and more polarized where there are just fewer sort of like partisan, bipartisan, agreements and cooperations, right? And you get these things. In fact, Biden, speaking of one of our candidates, he was accused of what do we call those? The primaries, in the Democratic primaries, probably by Kamala Harris, about like, well, didn't you vote once with a Republican? How dare you? And it used to be the mark of an effective senator that you could reach across the aisle. And you do the things together that you know that you want to do together, right? Mm-hmm. And then there are these parts where you just are going to disagree. That's been gravitating. But what's interesting, because I'm going to bring this back to technology, and then I'm going to spend 10 minutes telling you what I want to say about Cringely. And then we do got to move off Cringely because there's just other great topics to get to. I love the history, though. I love it. But you would think with the amount of communication, capacity, right? Infrastructure, et cetera, right? The communication infrastructure, applications, portability, boom, it's all right here, right? That we would have an unprecedented opportunity and ability for nuanced conversation. But it feels like exactly the opposite, right? You'd think, well, it's the 1800s, it's 1840 or whatever. I don't know if that was a presidential year, election year. But, let's just say it's 1840 and you're on this whistle stop tour, as they call it, because you would go on a train and you'd stop at every town at the train station. You'd stand on the back of the caboose with the draped American flag thing. And you'd be like, people of what town are we in? Lake Wobegon, right? And and then you would say your thing, and you have to talk loud because there weren't microphones. And so when you talked loud, you came off like this, And that was the thing. And I would say my piece, and then we'd hustle on into the next town, And it feels like we've entered a weird twilight zone where, with never having had a greater opportunity and capacity for nuanced conversation in my lifetime, it feels like we've never had less nuanced conversation. Now, I don't know that that's true either, right? I mean, that's my heuristic, my sort of back of the napkin feel, but.
Mm-hmm. I think it's felt that way for me at least, because I don't know. I've been politically involved. I'm young, so I've only really been politically involved for maybe 8-10 years.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think for me it's kind of felt the same way, because like, let's think about right now, like the stuff that's recently happening, especially with police, right? The moment that you critique the idea that all cops are bad, you're automatically an apologist for police brutality. There's no nuance there. You don't even have a chance to state your position. You don't even have a chance to say, hey, that's maybe right. I think police brutality is bad, but that doesn't mean that all cops are automatically white supremacists. Yeah. You know what I mean?
And you're accused of dog whistling your white supremacy.
Right. Yeah. You're automatically, and it happens from both sides of the issue.
That's right.
The moment,
that's right.
You know, the moment that you're not just bootlicking all the police, you're like, wow, you're some radical leftist, aren't you? You know, it's so impossible to even have some kind of opinion that's not on, you know, the fringes. That's not
that's right.
The limit of the function.
And I think that's weird. And one of the things that I've tried to do, I'm going to say one last kind of cap on this. I hope this has been interesting anyway. And then I do want to just kind of give a couple quick things about Cringely before we wrap up today, and then we can just kind of move on from the history. But one of the things that I try to do is I have friends across the spectrum. I don't knowingly have any friends that are white supremacists, and I don't have, you know, knowingly have any friends that are members of Antifa or whatever. There are extremists across the spectrum that I don't think I have friends that are, you know what I mean? That, mm-hmm. you know, whatever, the kill a cop people or whatever. But I do have friends that are what I think of as sort of intelligent and reasoned on both sides, right? And one of the things that I'll do is I'll reach out to them in a private messaging thing, either on text or on Discord or Slack or, you know, Facebook Messenger. And I'll say, okay, you're the most reasonable person that I know as far left as you are, right? Mm-hmm. I would lead like this. Or you're the most reasonable person that I know as far right as you are. What, you know, I would lead like this. There is this thing that's making me insane. Can we have a lengthy and reasoned conversation about it? And in that case, the technology is very enabling, right? Mm-hmm. And it is really amazing because you start drilling down on let's get to where we agree. You know what I mean? Like when one of my very leftist friends referred to the Chaz in downtown Seattle as leftist cosplay, it made me very, very happy. Only because he's a leftist, you know? And he himself was like, yeah, that's insane. And you know what I mean? And I think the same would be, you know, what could, you know, has come from the other side as well, where you're politically over there, right or left, but you're self-aware enough to be cognizant that there are these people going extreme from where you are that are losing their minds, and you can call that out, you know what I mean, intelligently. But if he said, but if he posted that publicly, he would be creamed. But he could say it to me in a private conversation where I could say the same thing about, you know, other friends, etc., right? Anyway, it's fascinating, and maybe give some thought about, and we, you know, we're going to roll into social media next week. Why isn't it better, right? Why isn't it better with all the technology we've got, right? Ugh, I want to hit this. I got to go. I'm going to go 9 minutes. 9 minutes of Cringely. I hope this has been therapeutic. You know, we don't have, I don't know. We're in a very strange place, and this is computers and society. You know what I mean? This is the ethical computer, whatever we call this class. I don't even know. I want to hit a couple of things really quick. There's a point where Waz says at the end of the first episode that there was a short window of time. Thanks, Devin, for the official title of this class I teach. Waz says there was a short window of time. Okay, my question to you, and maybe just noodle on this and drop comments. Are we past the era of short windows of time where one or two people, we call them Ted in the Shed, Ted and Ned in the Shed, a couple people that just get together and do a thing and change the world? Are we past the point where that can still be done, or can that still be done? Okay, that's drop that question and feel free to chat it up. Okay. By the way, some of the stuff, like there's a part where they talk about clean room and reverse engineering, right? How Compaq made this compatible ROM BIOS. We're going to talk about that later when we get to legal stuff. Okay? Because clean rooming software, it has some unique and interesting things, and I've had some legal cases that I've worked on that dealt directly with that. By the way, just as a little bit of kind of points of historical context, Ballmer talks about riding the bear and OS2, right, working with IBM. That's when I was at HP. I was 29. It was 1988, 89. And I was working on HP's release, OEM release of OS2 on the original HP Vectra personal computer, rewriting the device drivers. My spec for the device drivers were the DOS things, the DOS stuff in the ROM BIOS that I had to rewrite as multi-threaded OS2 device drivers. So back at when the time that Ballmer's talking about, they're riding the bear, and I actually had access to OS2 code, core code, kernel code, that I could look at code and tell you whether it was written by an IBM engineer or a Microsoft engineer. That clash of culture, so freaking real. But literally, I could look at the IBM code and I knew that that came from IBM, and I could look at the Microsoft code and tell that that came from Microsoft, even without looking at the, you know, the copyright, because they did collaborate on that. I also wanted to say there's one point in there where Bill Gates says that they had this argument with IBM and that they keep telling them that GUI was the way to go, as if OS2 wasn't GUI. And I don't even know what he was talking about there. OS2 was absolutely GUI. It had a thing called Presentation Manager. It predated Windows. It was a better DOS. You could run DOS, you know, in a DOS box. You could run Windows in a DOS box. OS2 was multi-threaded. It was freaking amazing. Okay, I just want to say I was an OS2 fan/fanatic from 1988 until 96, 97, almost a decade, that was my operating system, and I ran Windows in it, but it would just run Windows apps natively. It was great until they made a horrible, horrible decision and created a product that just wouldn't work at all and forced me basically to go to Windows. So I was living all that OS2 stuff, the IBM OS2. There's another interesting thing relative to antitrust stuff and the lawsuit brought against Microsoft. There were situations in which there were potentially, as I understand it, conflicts between the applications group at Microsoft and the OS group at Microsoft. In particular, at a time when WordPerfect had a dominant market position in word processors, and they were told, people I know, were told by Microsoft back then, people at Microsoft, that everything was OS2 and they should definitely build. WordPerfect had built their entire product for DOS in assembly language. Okay, this is now, we would call this technical debt, is what we would call that today. Massive technical debt, and they needed to rewrite the whole thing. That was the boot screen, but there was a graphic user interface called Presentation Manager. Anyway, and they were told OS2 is the future, right? When you do your GUI for WordPerfect, do it on OS2. They did, and then it was after that the break with IBM happened, and then Microsoft was all Windows, and they had Word rolling out for Windows, and it was basically WordPerfect tried to play catch up. That was another product that I used from 1985. Was the first time I used WordPerfect on a mini computer, I think, or a mainframe. and I switched to Word when WordPerfect did things with their whichever version it was that literally forced me to install Word. There's some interesting dynamics in all that. Okay. John Warnick, who talks about Adobe, who was part of the Xerox PARC people, he said that they were telling the people in New York, the Xerox, you know, executives, that there was that they had this vision that was being created and that there was nobody to receive it. Did anybody think, when you watched that, Orders of Ignorance, anybody? Did you think Orders of Ignorance? I hope so. Nobody to receive it. Jobs later on says they were just copier heads. Okay, that is the problem where we talked about the Orders of Ignorance and how you get locked in to a certain way of viewing the world, you know? And when Jobs talks about, you know, that the people that they tried to hire, they were poets and musicians and artists and you know, who just happened to be, you know, incredible software engineers and hardware engineers. That to me is about expanding your view of the world in every respect. I just think it makes you more creative in every aspect. It makes you a better engineer in my attitude. Favorite moment for me, you want to sell sugar water for the rest of your life, or do you want to come with me and change the world? That's a great line. That's a great line. Oh, in 1984, the year that the Apple, the Macintosh was released, I was in Iowa City and going to school at the University of Iowa. My roommate, Dave, had a Mac. I actually played on the original Mac in 1984. It was like $2,500, and we're like, and you know, the part where he's talking about, you know, you really couldn't do much with it. We were like, yeah, Mac Write, Mac Paint. Okay, Dave, that's great. You know, what do you do with it? I mean, it was cool. It was cool. And we were all like CS majors, and Dave just wanted to have one. He bought one, you know. Anyway, but yeah, I actually played on that original Mac in 1984. I want to say one other thing about the great man theory. We're about out here. Yeah. The great man theory, bring it back just a little bit. I do want to say this, that companies really, so Romney was actually right when he said companies are people, okay? I really absolutely, we can debate that one offline as well. Take me on, come, you know, come at me, bro. I don't care. Romney was absolutely correct legally, economically, and sort of personally. I've signed a lot of contracts in my life. I've made a lot of deals with companies, right? In my life, I've never made a deal with a company. I've only made deals with individuals. I've never had a contract signed by a company. I've had contracts signed by individuals. And when I've signed contracts representing a company, the company is legally the people that are the shareholders in that company. Whether it's a public company and the shareholders are, you know, mom and pop or you know, retirement funds and you know, all other, you know, all the various investments and whatever that invest in the stock market, or if it's, you know, like a small limited partnership like I've had with, you know, one partner, two partners, you know, and you each own a third or something, and it's a little LLC or something. Either way, the company is the conglomeration of the people working in it and the people who own it in some varying, you know, kind of combination. And so the notion... no, exactly right, Denver. Yes, yes. It is, in my mind, it never makes any sense to say it's not personal, it's just business. Which I think, where's that line come from? The Godfather? You know, hey, it's not personal, it's just, it's business. At some level, that doesn't make any sense, depending upon what it is you're doing that you're blaming on it being business and not personal. In my mind, as a business owner, founder of companies in the past and owner of companies. It really is always at the end of the day, people, you know, people are just everything. And, you know, you trash your people at your own sort of corporate peril. That's just economics. because we are in a free market system where if somebody thinks I'm a putz, which I may very well be, they get to leave and go to work for somebody else. And I can't keep good people. I hemorrhage people when I suck as a boss. Or you know what I mean? Anyway, there's some dynamics there we can get to. But I really do want to just say it is, well, that's why I said last time, build your LinkedIn network, right? Have those connections, keep that network. It really is at the end of the day about people. And here's the interesting thing. If you have a company that you feel you can't trust that company, look a little closer and it's going to be a bunch of people you can't trust. And when you have a company that your gut says, we can really trust that company. When I've heard people say that, they never really say, we can really trust Brand X. They'll say, I really feel like I can trust those guys. You know what I mean? They refer to the people that make up that company and that become kind of the DNA, the ethos of that company. And there are companies that just seem to spawn, you know, people I've worked with where it's just like, man, I can't trust any of these people. You know, there's a cultural thing that kind of attracts similar, like-minded kinds of things. So anyway, we're out of time. Heaven help us all. God bless us, everyone. Man. Anyway, your contribution has been great. I hope that you're not like sitting there going, well, I want to learn a new programming language. Plenty of time for that, my friends. But this is not the place. This is not where you're going to learn a new programming language. But do go learn new programming languages. Okay, listen, I'm out. What? Social media. I'll send out an announcement to let you know what's going on. We're figuring it out as we go. Next semester, they'll think I'm a genius. You'll know better. So, all right. Be safe, everybody. Have fun. Be safe, etc. We're not far away from fall break. Yes. Yes. And then Thanksgiving. Yes. I'm living for the breaks. Okay. All righty. See you, everybody.
See you guys.